22 degrees out right now. We gotta get this fire started. Not good.
The other way. We are definitely dragging anchor. I bet we're, we're dragging an anchor and the motor won't start.
Right, so I'm trying to start the boat and it's just clicking. But I have so many batteries and I've just been charging the batteries for so, it says 13 volts right there. So I don't think it's the battery thing. I come in here just to check. First thing I always check is heat. This is all kind of warm. This is very warm. So you see this wiggling? It might be shorting here. So I'm gonna try and tighten this up. It might just be a bad battery too, we'll see. It's not freezing out. I mean, it's not pleasant out. It's cold, it's like in the 40s, but I'm just, I figured I'd try this out today just to make sure that when it was freezing cold that it would work. I've used it several years. The last time I had a fire in it was when I put the fireplace back together. I had to take it apart to replace this whole wall behind it. So I'm not too worried, but I just wanted to make sure everything's working right and we weren't getting any smoke through any of these cracks or anything. The one bad thing about this type of stove, and it's really bad with the pets, because if you do something, like if I open the hatch, or if you do something to change the wind flow in here, you can get smoked out real quick if this isn't just going straight up, so. Ooh. Feisty little fire. So here's the trick to like have a longer fire in a tiny stove is you use the wood briquettes, which is basically charcoal or burned wood, and it just burns longer. That way you can get a few, you know, you can load it up a little bit and kind of get a few hours, 3 or 4 hours without having to reload it. Yeah, it's been a couple hours now. It still goes, you know, you just add a little handful of charcoal every couple hours. And you got something good there. Put a bunch in to get 4 or 5 hours. Really cool, this river growl. The river knows what's going on better than I do. I didn't even know that boat was going by. It's a pretty cool guy, I met them last night. So what I learned from my houseboat is that having a way to drive from inside is pretty cool. It's beyond cool. In fact, you don't think about it.
You don't think about it because when you use your boat normally, it's always nice out. Like if you just use your boat on the weekend, you're not going to go on a Saturday when it's raining and horrible out, you know? But when I was in the houseboat on like snowy, crappy days, you go for a ride on the inside with the heater running, and it's the best day because no one's out. It's beautiful. Who doesn't like going out, like watching storms and watching the rain, you know? It's just driving through it. So my next sailboat. All
right. So a bunch of things that I learned from having this sailboat that I would do again if I bought, that I wouldn't do again if I had another sailboat. Number one. You want to have a indoor cabin, or somewhat indoor. So they make sailing trawlers or motor sailors. I would get that. The other one is my fin keel is the best keel for sailing. It is the fastest way to get a cruising boat to move around. I mean, when I'm sailing, I'm actually keeping up with racing boats with all my shit in the boat. So it's a great keel to have for that. It's not a great keel to beach with. You can't go anywhere near the damn beach. So I would have a split keel where you could pull your boat up on the beach. And there's just two keels to rest it flat. I'd like to pull my boat up on the beach and have the tide go out and have the boat sitting on the beach to do work on the boat. That's not something I can do.
The other thing is, I would like a motor, a more significant motor. So that motor sailor concept is what I would be looking for. Something that you can drive from the inside. I would trade off being able to sail really fast for being able to motor up short, shallow rivers. You know what I mean? 30 feet is great for one person, but 37 feet would be better. Yeah, just things that happen. Not good. I mean, I'm stumped. I have tried to get the starter to go. I've hit it with a hammer. I've shorted it out. Nothing's working.
A couple things have happened.
One, I am positive that it's not the batteries that are causing the problem. I've had them charging long enough that they're all above 13 volts. So I'm going to try to skip the solenoid and get... I don't think it's a starter. I mean, I've hit the starter over and over and it's not... That's not what's... It's the solenoid clicking. So I'm going to try to just bypass the solenoid by putting, you know, a pliers to connect the two points and see if that helps. This point, I'm just going to try to bypass the ground to the starter to see if that's the problem. What bothers me is that the starter's not even clicking or even trying to move or anything. So it's just, to me, it's like shorting out or stopping. So I'm gonna try to ground it. So I took the bolt out holding the starter in place and I'm grounding it right there, and then I run that to the battery directly. Just bypass if there's a short somewhere. Starting to get down on myself a little bit. I've grounded that to the battery and it's not working. I am noticing a lot of heat on this positive wire, and when I ran it for a long time just sparking it out, there's some smoking. And I think it's got to be that it's, you know, if that wire is shorting somewhere or if it's just a bad connection, it's getting hot. That wire, both batteries are running through that wire, so that would make sense that it doesn't matter what battery I'm using or how I ground it, it's still not working. So I'm going to try to bypass that wire. It's kind of my last shot. It's pouring. Soaking wet. No fun. Basically, what I'm checking right now is to see if it grounded out when I touched the two wires together to bypass the solenoid. And if you look real close, yeah, it sparked out, which means there is a short inside the starter, and we have to take the starter off and have it rebuilt. Period. There's nothing I can do to get this.
At this point, I have my space heater pointed at the starter, thinking that it'll dry the starter out and there won't be a short. It's 5 o'clock. I spent the whole day. I can't get to the bottom bolt of the starter, so I try to fix everything. I try to figure out if it was a short. Essentially, I disconnected the entire starter and ran brand new wires from the positive and negative of a battery that I knew had a voltage on it. And then the starter still had the same problem. What's happening is, coming from the solenoid to the starter, it's shorting out somehow on the starter. And the solenoid is smart enough to know there's something wrong with the starter and it won't kick it over. But when I bypass it and I just run a positive wire directly to the starter without the solenoid, it will shut off my batteries because it's shorting out rather than just running the starter. That means to me that there, when it rained last night and there's water dripping down, there's water in the starter. It's the only thing I can think of. Or while I was driving, something was rubbing and now there is a part where it can jump. So what it comes down to is I gotta get that starter out. and I don't have the right tools here to do it. So right now I'm going to take like a 2 or 3 hour break. I might even not even look at it till tomorrow. I'm going to maybe watch a movie or something. And then worst case scenario, I tow it with the dinghy. I hook up the dinghy on the side of the boat and I tow the sailboat with the dinghy to a marina. Problem is, all the marinas here are too shallow for me to get into. Maybe I have to call a guy and just go pick him up at the marina and have him come here with tools to get the starter out, then rebuild the starter. I don't know. I gotta get the starter out. I'm gonna try to get the starter out. It's just... Pelicans. You know, it's good that they fly off now, because River was just going to chase them away in a second anyways. Fly, pelican! Stay over here, bud. He is fired up for... He's always so excited in the morning. Well, the sun is coming up, and we need it to come up because it is 26 degrees. We had a fire this morning to warm up the boat. You can't even really see the boat because of the fog, but it's there. It's there. Out there somewhere. Yeah. This starter thing... You know, it's got me, I don't know, it's been a long time since I've been frustrated about something and not just trying to tackle it. And for some reason, all the complexities of trying to figure out where to take a starter and not having a car and needing to use the dinghy, and I can't even get the starter out. River! Stop it, dude. We've been playing fetch for 20 minutes. With the tools that I have. I'm sure a mechanic. I don't know. I don't know if they pull the motor to do that. I don't know. So. Yeah. I'm going to call the mechanic that rebuilt the motor. Today. And ask if he... If you can get the starter out without pulling the motor, and then I'm going to pull the starter motor. Even if I have to go buy tools or something, and then I'm gonna take it to get it rebuilt. And all while it's 20 degrees out, so, sucks. It would be great to just motor, but
look, he went all the way back to the boat to go get his ball, and I'm about to cut firewood, so. Oh, he got a smell, but watch, he's gonna show up and start barking at me for not playing with him in a second. He's demanding a little bit.
Alright, we'll get off the road. Alright, hold on.
This is how I get my camera shot. Just gotta cut out a little rectangle here so I can put the phone in to hold it, see?
Look at that. Now I'm gonna go cut firewood.
Which I don't know why River thinks I should play with him instead of figure out how to make a cat warm tonight when it's 21 degrees out.
Hey, ready?
But it is a nice sandy beach, so it's good for him to play out here. Never had any problems with the starter, ever. There was one year where I started the motor over and over and over and over because the motor wouldn't work. So I had to run it all the time to start it. Ready, buddy? Go over there. Main thing I've learned about fires in tents and fires and sailboats and little place you found it, huh? Go this way, buddy. You don't want to have a really hot fire. As soon as it starts to heat up the chimney, everything goes bad. So you want to have a little fire to get the oven hot, but not the chimney. You want to almost be able to touch the chimney where it goes through the tent or the boat, whatever. You know, you don't ever want that to be that hot that it would start on fire there. And if you were an idiot and built this huge fire in a little tiny place like that, it would only take a amount of time before the double wall or that area would start on fire. Look how far this little snail made it already, since last night. Good job, little guy. Ooh, there's a horsefly. Did you get it? Alright, you wanna play fetch? Then let's go check out the pelicans. Maybe there's pelican poop where they were. And you can add that to the dead fish and dead opossum smell you got going on. Couldn't make it any worse.
This is all the pelican footprints. Look at that. That's funny. Pelicans are funny. So in all the phone calls that I made yesterday, I left a voicemail for the person who... The lady who lived above the river... I'll get the name of the marina. And I'll put it right on here. Because she's helping me out. She called me back asking what I wanted, and I said, this is the situation. Maybe could I possibly tow my boat in there? And her depth is only 6 feet, so I cannot get in there. But she said, we have a mechanic that comes here to work on boats. His name is Tanner. Let me call him, and here's his number. Text me. She called him. He called me, and he's basically... Ideally, he would like if I got the starter and brought it to him, but I don't have the tools. So I'm going to go pick him up, bring the tools here. He's going to try to get the starter out and then take it with him to get it rebuilt and then come back and put it on. That's where we're at right now. And the hope is that he can get the bolt out in some way.
Going to get the mechanic. Let me just take the battery.
Right. Look at this, my man. Alright, that's the first step.
Doing a late night run back to the boat. Just dropped off Tanner. He was able to get my starter out. Now I gotta go find my boat in the darkness.
back from dropping off the mechanic. Whew, that was a cold ride. It's like way below 30 degrees. It's not fun out at nighttime here.
22 degrees out right now. We gotta get this fire started. So, I have a lot of luck just using one or two of these. Throw them in the bottom and it lights up the wood up that you put up top. Maybe a little cardboard, but other than that, I don't have to really do much. The design of the stove makes it pretty easy to start a fire in. Funny how a dry 22 degrees or 23 degrees feels warmer than like a damp 40 degree day. Yeah. So it's about 7:30, almost 8 o'clock. We kind of slept in because the blankets were warm in the boat, wasn't it? We're going to run and take River to the island for an hour or so. He needs a good run. I got coal in the fireplace and I have the generator running with a little electric heater. So Cricket's just enjoying a warm morning. So I just got a text from Tanner telling me that the he just dropped off the starter to get rebuilt this morning. So they think it'll only take him a day. I've seen a guy, it's about how much they have to do that day. It's not about my starter. Because it only takes him an hour to rebuild a starter. So I'm looking at all these little tracks like I do every morning with River on the beaches. And I'm trying to figure out what that is. It looks to me like a tiny hoofed animal, like it's some kind of smaller deer. On this island would be weird, I guess. I guess it wouldn't be impossible. Tell me if you guys know what that is. Here's, look at these little raccoon paws.
Or it could be a cat paw. Look at that. I think it's raccoon.
And then my dog. This is River. That's where River's been. Of course, that's all he wants to do. One of the reasons I picked this harbor, and one of the very, very lucky reasons that I'm okay with having the starter be bad in this, is, yeah, he's just too much, dude. It's like 8 o'clock in the morning and he's acting this way. Probably shouldn't have get him wet, but it was a bad throw. So, my point is, before River rudely interrupted me, and he's going to do it again, too. Go for a walk. Come on, go walk around the island. Let's go for a walk. Come on, bud. Now he knows to go explore. He left the ball, too. He's so cute. Alright, so, what I'm trying to say, I keep getting interrupted and off topic, is the barge coming. It can't go through my way of the river right here. It has to go this way around. So the barges go around this huge island that we've been staying on for this last 4 days. And big boats do too. Sometimes you get cruisers or loopers coming through. But they typically go no wake when they come anywhere near me, because they anchor out in the water too. But any of the boats that want to keep up speed are typically going all the way around the big island. And I'll show you on a map what we're talking about, too. But that buoy right there is telling them that they can't come in here. That's saying they have to stay on the opposite side of that buoy. So you can see he's already aiming up to go around the long way around. It's pretty cool. I wonder if the opossum is gone. If something ate it. River. You wait up, little guy. Alright, so it's up here and River's acting like it's still there, so. Yep, it's still there. I wonder why that is. Like, oh, there's a lot more. Someone came and ate a lot off of it. Basically, it's just a fur left.
And that tooth. Look at that freaking tooth.
Gnarly.
Because it's so cold, it doesn't even really smell. Hey, get away from that. That's how you catch, like, opossum problems.
So I saw deer tracks on the island this morning. And I look and I think I see, like, a log coming towards the boat. But I'm like, that makes no sense because it's going against the current. And then I look and, yeah, sure enough, it's a deer. It's the head of a deer. Yeah, it's the head of a deer swimming across the river, going to the island. And it's really far away, so I won't have a very good picture of it. But what are the chances of that happening in the same, like, 2 hours? There he goes. Look how deep the water is, still right there. The deer can't touch the ground. That's why I can drive right up to the shore without pulling my motor. I wish I had a longer lens. This is happening pretty far away from us. Like, river can't even see it. The river hasn't noticed it. There he goes. Yeah, and it's a small female deer. Swam all the way across the Tennessee River to get to this little island. It's crazy. What's on the island that's so important? Oh, River just saw it. The wind is coming out of the north. And the current is heading north. So it's causing these waves, right? Now, the boat typically would face into the wind and you wouldn't feel the waves. But because the current is coming from the opposite direction, the back of the boat is actually facing the wind, and I'm feeling the waves. It's kind of frustrating. So a lot of people, if this was going to happen for, like, you know, a day, a whole day, a lot of people would throw the anchor in from the back of the boat, and the current would turn the boat around. Or they just go grab the line from the front of the boat and hook it up to the cleat back here and not pull the anchor. I'm not going to do that. I'm just going to, because the wind's going to die. The wind's already starting to die down over the last hour. And it's going to die down to like 4 miles an hour within the next 2 hours. So it should be a lot calmer in the next couple hours. Then tonight it's going to be 0 miles an hour. It's going to be a gorgeous night, even though it's going to be 20 degrees out. So it'll be pretty cool. I think I'm going to take River to shore for a good, at least an hour, and I won't have to deal with this rocking.
The wind's coming from the other way. We are definitely dragging anchor. I bet we're dragging an anchor, and the motor won't start. This is actually really good information for everybody. It's a really scary situation for me because I don't have a motor. However, my dinghy is capable of towing the sailboat, so should something really go wrong, I could fix it. This is the map of where I was the last couple of days anchored, tracking me for 9 hours anchored in the same spot. Now, this is the map that's showing where I'm at right now.
Out the window, and these houses were so much closer, and I felt like we were moving, but there was so much wind that you don't really know if you're moving or if it's just the waves. And once I saw them, I pulled up my GPS from the night before. Every night I go to bed, I turn on a tracker to record how, you know, from like 7 o'clock at night till 7 in the morning where my boat is. And anytime that I wake up at night, I can look at it and know that my boat's in the same spot just from watching what it's been doing on the GPS tracker. It's a really, really good way to not have to get out of bed and look at things or worry about things. So I pulled my map up to start another GPS tracker, and when I looked at where I'm at, I knew instantly I had dragged, you know, a couple hundred feet. Upriver, amazingly, because the wind was so strong. And then I felt my boat jerk, which meant it was grabbing again.
So then I thought, since I don't have a motor and it's just re-caught, I don't want to try to move anything or do anything now because I'm going with the wind. I'll have to wait until there's no wind to do anything, if I even do anything. So, yes, this episode is going to end with the boat having stuck about 50 feet from the opposite shore over there, next to an RV park. And me not knowing whether or not my starter is going to actually be rebuilt, or if I'm going to have to wait a week to get a new starter, or what. You'll have to tune in next time, at another time, another place.